I'm going to be leading towards the conversation about how to reach people, particularly reach people in the next generation, because I'm convinced that the moment we're in does not pause the mission we're on. But I don't know if you've noticed, the moment we're in is very different than just 5 years ago. And so I want to talk some about that and talk some about that journey, because sometimes we might think that the world's the same, but the world's different. The gospel remains the same. How do we show and share the love of Jesus in a broken and hurting world? So I'm going to talk through what I'm calling a post-COVID missiology. So I'm a missiologist. I have a PhD in mission. Well, here, part of my job is to help us kind of think about the cultural moment and how the moment we're in does not pause the mission we're on. The moment we're in does not pause the mission we're on. So through this presentation, I'm going to share some stats, I'm going to share some articles, I'm going to share some different kinds of information, and I'm going to go somewhat quickly. I'm actually from New York City. Anybody from New York here? See, they're always loud. Yeah, of course. But I'm with you, man. I'm with you. And so I'm I talk a little faster than most people do. And so I'm going to give you all of my notes. As a matter of fact, if you want to download this presentation, this whole presentation, including all the notes, you go to hegetsuspartners.com/EPC. My notes, my outline, and this actual presentation are all there for you to download if you're so inclined. But again, what I'm talking about today is three ongoing realities in reaching the nones. But let me just tell you that you know, right now we're still thinking about the pandemic, but we're actually going through a series of pandemics, and sometimes we don't realize just how conflicted the cultural moment actually is, and that's what part I want to talk about today, is how conflicted it is. Matter of fact, I'm going to talk about some things. Like even when I mentioned the pandemic, it's some of you, something rises up in you. And you're like, well, wait, no, I might say, well, if I say something about the pandemic, someone will say, well, I think we took it too seriously. And someone else next to you says, well, I didn't think it was seriously enough. And I just want to start with, I'm going to do some description in the first session and then some prescription towards evangelical mission in the second session. And if I could just ask you not to ramp up internally when everything I mention might be something you have a strong opinion on. To quote theologian Taylor Swift, you need to calm down. Okay. So, because we're walking through a season and coming out of COVID, right? And so, some people are like, no, we're not. We're still in the midst of this. People are going to, and right now, two of our team members are very sick with, like not hospitalized sick, but sick with COVID. And so I get that people have different views of that, and I'll talk some about that. But we all can agree that we're treating it very, very differently. Of course, to be fair, depending on what part of the country you're from, you treated it very differently from the beginning. Those of you from Texas, you didn't participate in the pandemic at all. You just said, nah, no hard pass. And so you have been hugging and kissing each other on the mouth for 2 years. Well, here in Michigan, I tell you, they took a little bit different approach. And in Illinois, I was the interim teaching pastor at the Moody Church for 4 years, including to the end of the pandemic. I bet some of you probably have been to Founders Day or something of that sort there at the Moody Church. And Chicago, Illinois, very different than when I go down to Arizona and have a meeting or have a conversation. But what I want you to see, and I'm partly just going to touch on this, it's not the main point of that, is we're actually in a season right now of six pandemics, at least six pandemics. One's a pandemic of disease, right? But there's a great sense of distrust in culture. As a matter of fact, some of you are already feeling it right now. When I started talking about the pandemic, someone said, I'm not sure I trust what he's about to say about that. That's a pandemic of distrust in our culture. There's a pandemic of defamation from technology. We're all one social media post away from a crisis that someone can say whatever they want, and there's no accountability, and it's sometimes a place where the powerless have a voice. Sometimes it's something that becomes something that's untrue. There's a pandemic of disorientation and identity. And I'm not just talking about things like gender identity that come to mind, but people are saying, well, who am I? You know, who am I culturally, ethnically, racially? Who am I? Am I an evangelical? Am I a born-again Christian who doesn't want to use that term anymore? How does all this fit together? There's a disorientation in identity. There's a disruption to mental health. I don't think we even have a clue how significant the mental health disruption will be for the next few decades related to the last few years. And we're seeing some of those realities. And then there's a division in church in a way that probably you haven't seen in your lifetime. You're leading in probably what is the most divided time for most of us to have led through in the last few years. The division in the culture has seeped into the church. I bet there's very few churches here that somebody hasn't left because of what you said or didn't say, what you did or didn't do about something in the last 2 years. I see lots of heads nodding. So we're living in a really tumultuous and turbulent time, but I've read the end of the book, right? We're still to be on mission, showing and sharing the love of Jesus until Jesus returns. So there's three things I want us to look at today in our post-COVID reality, three things that I want us to walk through that I think will help us. Let me say, occasionally, like these six pandemics, I wrote about, if you were interested. I'm the editor-in-chief of Outreach Magazine. If you Google Ed Stetzer, six pandemics, I go through these and sort of what they mean and how we might walk through. So to give you that additional information is always available. Most of the things I talk about here I've actually written on before, and I'll just unpack a little bit more as we go. So three things. Number one, I want to talk about COVID and our cultural convulsion. COVID and our cultural convulsion. One of the things that seems to have happened in the last few years is that that something ramped up, right? There's a cultural convulsion unlike anything that we've seen in our lifetime. Now, if you're old enough to have a living memory of the 60s, I'm going to talk about that in just a little bit, you might say, okay, I could see how this might feel similar to the 60s. Right, the cultural convulsion, though, is the idea that it appears that, well, let me tell you where I got the idea of every 60 years. This is an article by David Brooks. David's a relatively new follower of Jesus. I don't necessarily agree with everything David writes, but in The Atlantic, he writes this: America is having a moral convulsion. Like I say, he's a relatively new follower of Jesus. We had him in class at the Wheaton College Graduate School to talk about this article, and the conversation there led me in a different direction, a similar direction, built on what he wrote about it in Outreach Magazine. And I talked about it's not just America, and it's not just moral. So it's not just America's having a cultural, a moral convulsion, because it's global, right? Yesterday I was talking to someone from Brazil, and two days before that, we had students from the Philippines. And when I teach at Oxford this fall, they specifically asked me to address some of the cultural convulsion they're experiencing. So throughout the world, we seem to be in a cultural convulsion. But what David wrote is that every 60 years, America seems to go through a moral convulsion. And the last time we did that was the 60s, then the late 1800s, then the mid-1800s, when basically Americans look to one another and maybe say, well, let's look at the subtitle, levels of trust in this country, in our institutions, in our politics, and in one another are in precipitous decline. And when social trust collapses, nations fail. Can we get it back before it's too late? So in the course of our conversation, when we was in class, we talked about this. All the students in that class are pastors. Some people pressed on this, some people pressed on that. And I think, like I said, I don't think it's just America. I think it's we together globally are going through a cultural convulsion. And I think it's cultural, not just moral. I think people have decided they don't trust each other. They don't believe one another. They're mad at each other. Social media has become a shark tank. Twitter is no fun anymore. Things have just shifted in our culture. We're in the midst of a cultural convulsion. Now, you might say, well, what is this? I mean, how is that a cultural convulsion? If you don't mind, I want you to help me. I want you to participate with me. And then I want you to just calm down for just a moment as I kind of go through maybe the peak of the cultural convulsion. Not that we've come down from this, but maybe the peak. I think 2020, we began to see just how fully the cultural convulsion was. So I'm going to ask you to participate, but in the next few minutes, I'm going to mention several different things, right? I'm going to mention masks. I'm going to mention George Floyd. I'm going to mention the election. I'm going to mention Stop the Steal. I'm going to mention January 6th. I'm going to mention all kinds of other stuff. So just do this. Everyone take a deep breath. Didn't work for some of you. You're already ramped up just because I said some of that stuff. So let's jump in, right? You guys are a little nervous. State clerk's a little nervous already, but stay with me. You've heard me talk about this on Kerry Newhoff's podcast. But let's start with a quiz, and I want you to participate. I want you to just shout out, not now, but just shout out in January 2020, that's how the convulsing year of 2020 begins. What's the big global controversial news that made the division very, very clear? January 2020, shout it out. Sometimes I haven't heard anyone say it. What did you say? Impeachment. Now I want you not to miss it. People are like, oh yeah. I mean, that's where we are now in America. Oh, that's right. There was an impeachment in early 2020. Right? I mean, that was like a slow start to the year, right? So that's where it begins, right? And so it's just like controversy from the beginning, but we don't even remember it because 2020 kept going. Right? So soon thereafter, we began to hear what was first called the Wuhan virus, the Wuhan flu, later COVID-19. And people were already divided, greatly divided, but there was a sense that we sort of a little bit came together at the beginning of that. If you remember, President shut down the country for 2 weeks. You remember 2 weeks to stop the spread? I missed 2 weeks to stop the spread. It's a long 2 weeks. But everything kind of shut down and we felt the difference that was there. And you know, I came home. I'm an extrovert, so being locked away from everybody for 2 weeks really was hard for me. But Donna, my wife, she's an introvert, and so I said to her, you know, but 2 weeks in, the president comes back on, you can start to feel some of the division. People weren't communicating the same way by the time we got to the second extension of the shutdown. And so the president says we're going to shut down for another month, and then we'll be open in time. Remember Easter and all that. And so I said to Donna, my wife, you know, as an introvert, like, is this like amazing for you? We just stay home, don't be around people. And she smiled because she loves me, and she says, well, are you going to be here the entire month? Can you feel that? I love that woman. She does not fool with her husband. She's like, nope, you got to be quiet if you're going to be home that whole month. So then it went for a month. By the time you get there at the end, there's already division in how we should respond, right? So probably almost all of your churches paused gathering at that point. It's either 94 or 96. I should remember the stat off the top of my head. I don't. Shut down. The only churches that didn't tended to be small rural churches, right? And a few outlier churches, but it's mostly small rural churches where COVID hadn't hit. So most of you paused for a while. Depending how long you paused, you began to hear some people unhappy about your decisions. And there were some people, when you paused and you continued to pause your meeting, who began to use words. You could feel the momentum building that you're a compromised coward if you're listening and bowing before the state. Some of you are nodding, yep, I heard that. And then, because your elders, your session, your pastor's trying to figure this out, and then you maybe said, well, we'll meet, but we'll have mitigation. And then people said, you're going to meet? We're in the middle of a pandemic. You're a heartless fool. So either you're a compromised coward or a heartless fool, depending upon who you're talking to. But don't forget that in the middle of that, across television screens all around the world, we saw the murder of George Floyd. And people responded to that moment. Your church probably responded to that moment, right? The protests that followed that moment were actually larger than the civil rights protests of the 1960s. So my guess is you hosted some sort of conversation in early to mid-June about race and racial reconciliation, and maybe with a local church or a local pastor. If you're a predominantly Anglo congregation, you had a conversation with an African American pastor or leader, and maybe shared that their experience has been different, and maybe you said, well, our church wanted to be more involved, and maybe you recommended some resources. Maybe you mentioned George Floyd by name in church, people holding up signs saying "Say his name." Maybe you mentioned George Floyd in name, and you prayed for a more just society, right? But then you began to hear in the next few months, well, why did we mention him? And then the summertime came, and there were riots. I mean, huge riots. Now, I'm the interim teaching pastor in Chicago at Moody Church, and we're actually, we helicopter above our church, and there's a phalanx of police officers, and there's protesters, and behind them, there's some rioters, right? And it's interesting because depending upon if you mentioned George Floyd by name, but didn't mention the summer riots by name, people began to say, well, why did you mention one and not the other? Some of you are nodding your head. Some of you also nod your head because you were glad I mentioned the riots, because I mentioned George Floyd. You want to make sure I'd mention both. And a whole lot of people wanted to make sure that you mentioned both if you mentioned George Floyd. So, or maybe you mentioned the summer riots and you didn't mention George Floyd. And some people start saying, well, wait a second. And people are beginning to keep almost a mental list of what you and your church are saying or not saying. Do you remember this? And then the election. Yeah. And eventually Fox News calls Arizona and calls the election for President Trump. I use that network intentionally. Because then you have a decision to make. So my phone lights up and people say, well, what do we do now? I say, well, what do you mean we do? Our church, maybe your church does, my church does. We always pray for the president-elect after the election. And lots of pastors seem to do the same based on the text I got. Said, what do we do? Do we pray for President-elect Biden? Do we pray that the election will be fairly decided? And people are calling from your church saying, you should say something, and here's how you should pray. So the very prayer you're going to give, now people are saying, here's what you should, I see you smiling, you were there. That was a great year, wasn't it? We're in the 28th month of 2020. I mean, the division's still here, so my phone lights up, so I have we launched a podcast at the beginning of COVID. The podcast continues now. It's called the Stetzer Church Leaders Podcast. It's geared towards pastors and church leaders. So I texted a pastor I've known before he was famous, so I texted Rick Warren, and I said, listen, I need you to do a podcast with me on what you're going to say this Sunday about the election. Who are you going to pray for? How are you going to pray? And so he comes on, does the podcast, later tells me that that got him a lot of grief at his church, because he said, I'm going to pray for President-elect Biden here. Now, we're not even through 2020. It's not even a year later, and January 6th is here. January 6th, even today, people divided about whether we should be having hearings and things of that sort, right? But here's what you remember that's particularly grievous to you is when they broke into the floor of the House and the Senate, right? They got there and they prayed in Jesus' name. So maybe your church said something, but if you said something about that and you didn't say something about the election and you said something about George Floyd and you didn't say something about the summer riots, by now people are categorizing you and people are leaving your church over some of these issues. And this is the cultural convulsion and what it looks like. Now, don't misunderstand, the division in our culture didn't start in 2020, but it sure did accelerate in 2020, didn't it? We haven't even talked about masks, right? But all these things about what we do, what we don't do, how do we navigate through these things? How do we walk through these things? So I finished my interim up at Moody Church when the controversies were a little less evident because, you know, they had me back, you know, they shut down, and after they shut down, they had me back and did a kind of a goodbye thing, because I actually finished my interim at Moody Church during shutdown. How many of you actually visited Moody Church's building at some point, maybe for a service or for congregation? Lots of you have been there, right? It's a beautiful building. And so I actually, in August afterwards, they did a nice reception for Donna and me. And so I came back and said, hey, thank you for letting me be your interim. Let me show you what the church looked like when I started. And I put a picture up of an Easter service. Everyone packed in, 3,750 seats. You've been there if you sat there. Warren Wiersbe used to say, come on in, grab any seat. They're all equally uncomfortable. And he was right. Just these hard wooden chairs. So I said, this is what it looked like when I started as the interim at Moody Church. And then I put up the next slide. This is what it looked like on my last Sunday. Wasn't anybody in the room because it was during shutdown. And it was funny at the moment, but the reality is, I mean, it was a jarring reality. So when I was serving and helping out with Cherry Hills, just doing supply preaching for Cherry Hills, there was more of the controversies had kind of arisen even at a higher level. You could feel it in congregations. And my guess is you have as well. So there's a cultural convulsion, and it continues. Now, here's the thing I want you to see. What Brooks writes about in this article that's so helpful, I agree with most of what he writes in this article. Don't agree with everything David writes, but what he writes in this article I found so helpful is the pattern that America seems to go through a cultural convulsion every 60 years. We just kind of get to the place we just don't trust one another. We don't believe the news sources. We create our own ways of getting, you know, in the 60s it might have been alternative publications. They say, no, there's just a different reality. And right now, Americans are living in different realities from one another, and that's part of the cultural convulsion that we're walking through. The other thing that I think is helpful, if you look at past cultural convulsions, they don't last just 2 years. Here's what I want to say to you. If we're coming out of COVID, which we certainly are dealing and responding differently, and you know, who knows what the future holds? I'm not a prophet, I'm not the son of a prophet, and I work at a nonprofit organization, so I don't know. But here's what I do know, is that cultural convulsions don't tend to just end after 2 years. So we've probably got several more years, and it might get worse. Matter of fact, I'm actually of the view it's probably going to get worse before it gets better. And so what that means is, as pastors and church leaders, as elders and as members of the session, you're going to need to build reservoirs of resilience to make it through the next few years. We've already seen the toll this is taking on some pastors who've stepped away, who've stepped down, who've stepped out. If you're on an elder board or you're a part of a session, let me really just encourage you that your pastors and staff are going to need you to be there, walk alongside. You're going to need one another in ways that may not have felt the same 3 or 4 years from now. We're going to need reservoirs of resilience and supportive community as we walk through some of these challenging times together. But it's not just a cultural convulsion, it's also a cultural acceleration. Let me show you another article. This is called Waking Up in 2030. This is by Ross Douthat. He's a former evangelical who converted to Catholicism and very conservative Catholic, writes books calling the current Pope too liberal on things. But he writes this article in June 27th, 2020. So right now, this would be in the middle of some of the summer protests and riots. And it's really helpful framing, helped me to understand a little bit why the division is so evident. It's called Waking Up in 2030, and he uses race as an example. So what he says is, I mean, I'm paraphrasing, is that everyone's sort of accelerated or decelerated at different rates on questions of race in 2020. But I think it's real helpful for us to get a picture of the acceleration in general. Let me give you the example he gave. So if you are a... Let me talk to your world just a little bit. Right? I'm not a Presbyterian, though I'd like to be one on some days, particularly after my denomination's annual meeting. But that's another story for another day. But think in terms of how people that are influential in the Presbyterian space have expressed their view and views of how to address issues of race differently. Well, Douthat writes about this. So he says, so some people really accelerated in 2020, and he says, waking up in 2030, it's like we had a 10-year conversation in like 3 months, is what he says. So for some people said, you know, the whole system is inherently racist. Matter of fact, everything is built on a substructure, a rotting corpse, a substructure of racism. And if you just peel it back, we'll see the system's still inherently racist. And matter of fact, all of us are inherently racist because of how we were raised. And it's baked into the system. And you might say, well, I don't know Christians who think that. Well, actually, the provost of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, that's paraphrasing what he said. Now, Southern Seminary is a pretty conservative theologically institution. I think most of us would say we'd recognize that name. And it became controversial, but he kind of said, so the whole system itself, and you as part of the system, the racism is baked in, and we've got to consistently work to overcome that. And there are some people here who would actually say, you know, I think that. People accelerated on this, particularly around early 2020, but not everybody did. Some people accelerated a little less. I think a lot of people said, you know, I listened to some of those pastors in those Zoom dialogues we had in 2020, and I could see why their experience is different than mine. And when it comes to their property values, don't appreciate. Maybe there's systemic unfairness that's there. Maybe the way the policing is in their communities versus ours. And so some people say, you know, I do believe in systemic racism. I don't believe the whole system is systemically racist, but there's some places, and we got to work to make that better. And so some people accelerate at that point. And some people said, no, I don't think that at all. Some people kind of went the other direction. Matter of fact, when you say those things, if you even believe in systemic racism, might still be present in the fact that property values are different or educational outcomes are different in different communities. If you believe those things, well, that's critical race theory. And so people all sort of had a starting point in some ways, and some accelerated here, and some decelerated, and some accelerated less. And so for me, so I'm one who deeply cares. I do believe, you don't have to agree with me, I do believe that there are places in our society where there are still elements of remaining systemic racism that we need to work towards and work for. I don't necessarily hold that the whole system is, you know, I look at different place systems and say, these seem like good and healthy outcomes in places, and you might have a different view. But here's what Douthat points out, is it's if everyone had a 10-year conversation in 3 months and came to different views and got really angry at each other. And the acceleration is a huge part of our cultural moment. In fact, let me use an example he doesn't use about cultural acceleration. Let's talk about same-sex marriage. Just in case you're wondering if I wasn't going to hit on every single possible topic that we could hit on today. I'm not even warming up. Brad's like, what have we done? I think you're the one who suggested me to the EPC, aren't you, Brad? So let's talk about same-sex marriage. So same-sex marriage, Americans have changed their mind on same-sex marriage. We have not, but Americans have changed their mind on same-sex marriage. A percentage poll say the vast majority of Americans believe in same-sex marriage and believe it's a civil rights issue akin to race is what the majority of Americans believe. The vast majority have changed their mind. So here we find ourselves as evangelical Christians alongside with our Roman Catholic friends and others, and people of some other faiths, and being kind of holding a minority view in our culture. But America changed its mind over 40 plus years. So from Stonewall, which is where there was a protest and a riot, to Obergefell, which is the Supreme Court case, was making same-sex marriage law of land. That was over 40 years. And just a few years before Obergefell, the majority of Americans were not in favor of same-sex marriage. Now the vast majority are. America's changed its mind, but it took 40-plus years to get there. But what I want you not to miss is that a whole lot of people have changed their mind on gender identity in about 2 years. Cultural acceleration, right? So now, you know, I've been a pastor for 30-something years, and I can tell you that one conversation outside the last 5 years, one conversation in the prior 30 years have I had an in-depth pastoral conversation about somebody struggling with their gender identity. Maybe it wasn't a safe place. Maybe people weren't having the conversation. I don't know. But today, when I preach on anything close to this issue, people after church have questions, and it's someone in their family. Remember, the most recent study came out that now over 20% of young adults identify as LGBTQ+, more than 1 in 5. And so the shift is stunning. And actually, it's not, you can actually lose your job by what's called misgendering somebody. Actually, the Chicago Police Department, in the union contract with the city, says that you can lose your job as a police officer if you misgender somebody. In other words, don't identify or talk to somebody in line with their preferred gender identity and pronouns. So this is a conversation for most people that's 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 years old at the most. And don't misunderstand, people have been struggling with gender dysphoria for a very, very long time. But now it's become a front and center cultural issue. The culture has changed its mind, particularly those who control the levers of culture, media, entertainment, news. They've changed their mind. And again, we're trying to figure out how best to address it. My guess is that if you haven't had one already in the last 2 years, very soon your church will be having some sort of Bible study series or sermon series on how to address questions of gender identity. So cultural convulsion and cultural acceleration. Now again, almost not all of you, many of you are staff members or elders, and you're saying, how do we help minister to people in our church? Let me just tell you that people in the workplace, some of you are elders who have vocational outside of the church, people are dealing with this at the core of their identity and at work, and they're making this an issue at work. And for Christians who hold a different view about what it means that God has created us male and female, he created them, it's actually an employment issue for some people. So for us, it might be, how do we teach this at church? For people in our culture, as the culture is changing its mind, there are employment ramifications, and we've got to help them navigate that well. Now, I'm not going to pack all that for the sake of time, but what I want you to see is, first and foremost, that we are in the midst of a cultural convulsion and a cultural acceleration that's unparalleled in our lifetime. Now, I think if you go back to the 60s, you can feel similarly. I'm going to talk about that in just a little bit. But let me go on. So, number one, COVID and our cultural convulsion and the accompanying acceleration. Number two is COVID, post-COVID rally, and the Great Sort. The Great Sort. Let me explain a little bit what's going on here. So what seems to be happening is that people are sorting themselves. This is a church-based thing. The Great Sort's my terminology, so don't go out there and say, you know, well, the Great Sort I've been reading, unless you read my article, and no one else is using that terminology. But the Great Sort is people now are sorting themselves in a different way in the life of their church. Now, 50 years ago, right, the PPC didn't exist 50 years ago, but 50 years ago, if you moved from one town to another and you were Presbyterian and you know, Westminster and, you know, Reformed, and you would go from this town, you go to another town, you join a Presbyterian church. The reality is, what a lot of you know now is that people tend to look for a church more based on worship style and preaching style than theology. So 50 years ago, people chose things based on theology. Maybe 30 years ago, they still had a broad theology. They chose evangelical, but if they were EPC, they might not be EPC when they go to their new city. They might be some other evangelical. But it was a broad theological choice with some stylistic choices. I'm not saying these are all good. I'm saying this is what happened. Today, increasingly, people are actually choosing their church not based on its theology or its methodology, but they're choosing it based on its ideology. They want to hear more about the social issues of their day in line with the way they want to hear it. Now, why is that? So we just did the Barna National Pastors Update. Some of you probably watched the Barna National Pastors Update. And it was super fun. And David Kinneman did a really good job. I did the segment with Carrie Newhoff, and we kind of walked through some of the cultural issues of the day. Something David said was really awesome. I have three daughters, right? I have three daughters. They are, as of yesterday, 24. Just turned yesterday. She turned 24. I became a father 24 years ago on Father's Day, because my daughter was born on Father's Day. So she texts me and says, "You owe me every Father's Day." So I have a 24-year-old, I have a 20-year-old, and I have a 17-year-old. So that's both a statement of my situation and a request for your intercessory prayer. And they're amazing. I love my daughters. Girls rule. They have a lot of words, but they're amazing. So sometimes sitting at the dinner table, a lot of words, and I thought I was an extrovert. But anyway, so some of the words have to do with boyfriends, and I'm pretty opposed to boyfriends, just in general, though it seems to be inevitable and necessary. So one of the phrases I picked up for my daughters, right? I learned things from my daughters. I don't try to use their slang, because there's nothing sillier than a middle-aged man trying to use the slang of a 17-year-old. But the phrase that you sometimes we talk about one boy and this other boy, and one daughter would say to the other, "You know, I just don't think he's that into you." See, that's a phrase that the kids use. He's not that into you. So David Kinneman has kids the same age as my kids. The guy runs Barna Research. And so here's what he says at the Barna National Pastors Briefing. He says, "Pastors, here's what we found out the last 2 years. They're just not that into you." I didn't mean it personally, but here's what we found in the last 2 years. The discipleship for a whole lot of people didn't hold. Matter of fact, what we could say and point out to is that maybe the shallowness of our discipleship became on display, because obviously people are being far more discipled by their cable news choices today. And they're being spiritually shaped by their social media in far more powerful ways than they are by their congregational discipleship. And I hope we come out of the last few years saying we've got to build a more robust sense. Because what's happening is people are coming to church and they're saying, "Why didn't you say this? Or why didn't you talk about this?" And they're using words that you know that they heard on their cable news channel of choice, to the left and to the right. And you know, because you know, and here's the thing, they're hearing it 15 hours a week. And that home Bible study that you have on Tuesday night is simply not enough they're just getting overwhelmed by the discipleship of their cable news channel and their social media feed. And technology is a huge, huge challenge. Let me show you a piece of technology that's 2,000 years old. This is a pipe, and it's powerful. Rome, the city of Rome, had 1 million people 2,000 years ago. No city in the West had 1 million people again until London in the 1700s after Rome fell. So if you were, you know, a big city in 2,000 years ago, we'd be going to a city of 5,000 people. It'd be stunning how big it is. Some of you actually done tours of Israel, and you go to these places, and you're like, "Oh, Jericho, it wasn't that big." And you go to these places, "Well, Ephesus, it wasn't that big." You can actually walk through these things, not Rome. 1 million people because of the technology of the Romans, Roman roads, Roman aqueducts. And this right here, this metal that they discovered in mind, changed so much. They had hot and cold running water in the villas among the rich in Rome 2,000 years ago. Can you imagine? Hot and cold running water. And this metal, it was malleable. It was moldable and foldable. So you see, they didn't have welding, so they just folded over the metal and they made a pipe out of it, right? So there it is right there. So 2,000 years ago, they loved this metal so much, the rich would use it, make bowls out of it, make cups out of it. So it became a key part of how they engaged food and water. The problem was, this metal is lead. So 2,000 years ago, this technological marvel was feeding them. They literally eat out of it. It was feeding them and killing them and poisoning them at the same time. And I'm convinced 2,000 years later, what we hold in our hands are doing the same thing. It's not been good for your church. In all likelihood, it's not been good for your kids. I can show you the statistics how it's not been good for your kids. And more. Why? Because what's happened, actually, I mean, there were a whole thing. Facebook Papers came out last year, and it was leaked, and there was all these, the social dilemma, all on Netflix, and I watched it with my kids. Here's what we know. We're not unsure. We know that depression is up, self-harm is up, internal struggle is up when teenagers engage social media. We know that people are dividing themselves. Actually, we actually know the algorithms actually promote division. They cause you to get in an echo chamber with other people who are mad like you're mad. And it makes them money because of that. We know that Facebook's not the product, we're the product. And it's impacting your church. So this summer I preached out at Saddleback and filled in when Pastor Rick Warren was sick. And I decided to talk a little bit about some of these things, working through a text, and talked about the unity in the church. And here's what I said there, and maybe something you might consider saying in some version. I said, listen, sisters and brothers, if cable news is causing you to be at odds and out of fellowship with your local church, you need to choose your church over cable. You need to unplug it. You need to cut the cord. You need to unsubscribe from it. You need to choose your church over cable and social media, and stop believing things that somebody you don't know is telling you, rather than listening to the pastor that God has given you who can share God's word with you. Amen. Now, I heard the amen, and that one person with a very tepid applause. I appreciate that. Who was that? Who was that? I just want to, later on, we just give a hug afterwards. I love you, man. So the great sort is the place and space where people are sorting themselves. Now, my guess is you've had long-standing members who love Jesus and you love leave your church because you didn't say enough about this or that, and they went to a church to the right or to the left, based on where they are. Whereas 20 years ago, you would have rejoiced that people who had some different views about how best forward to do some things politically or culturally could stay together and united on the gospel. That has been frayed in ways like we've not seen in our lifetime. Thirdly, let's talk about COVID and layers of dis and re-engagement. So most of you, your attendance is down. Not everybody's different places, but the average, the attendance is down, depending on where you are. If you're in the north, the northeast, and the northwest, particularly northeast, northwest, and then in the cities and the central areas, you're 60-65% still. If you're in New York City, so I left Moody, and helped out Little Cherry Hills, but I became the interim of a church in New York City called Calvary. Some of you know Calvary's across the street from Carnegie Hall, Stephen Olford's old church. So I became the interim pastor there, and I got to tell you, New York City, hardest hit first and slow to come back, and we've really experienced that. Now again, different in Arizona, it's much higher, right? It's also different among different ethnicities as well. African-American churches have regathered at the lowest rate and at the slowest pace, and it's different among different ethnicities as well. But here's what's kind of interesting. Now, your attendance is probably down, but for most of you, your giving is at or above 2019 in your congregation. I see a lot of heads nodding. And not everybody. You're kind of like, well, how can that be if our giving's down and our attendance is up? I'm going to explain that in just a second. So if you go to the Assemblies of God Church, the people will tend to sit in the front who are the most engaged involved. So 100 seats, most engaged involved in the front. And think of a church of 100 people, right? So here's what seems to have happened in the last couple of years. The front third of the church, it would be the most involved people, not in typical Presbyterian church, but think in terms of we're all Pentecostals for this moment. The front third of the church has gotten more engaged and more involved. They've given more and they're serving more, which could mean for some of you, this has been your best year ever of giving. How many of you say this has been our best year ever? We're in the best season of giving right now. I see lots of hands going up. Okay. And your attendance is down. Not necessarily all of you. But why? Because the most involved already gave the most. They're giving more and they're serving more. So the front third has gotten more engaged and more involved. The second third sort of hanging on, waiting. We have it graphically, right? So more front third, more committed. The second third, hanging on and waiting. It's the back third. The back third's the biggest concern for me. The back third of a church of 100 people actually represents more than 33 people on a given Sunday. Because the back third of a church rotates in and out. They might come 3, 5, 7, 11 times a year, maybe Christmas, Easter, and a few other times. those people who were loosely connected seem to have disconnected potentially permanently. So the people you're missing are in two categories. One, they sorted themselves out to go to a church that they felt they were more ideologically aligned with, or they were in the back third who came occasionally and they disconnected perhaps permanently. Now, I love what I'm hearing from your stated clerk about we're going to be focusing and making a laser focus on evangelism. Here's the challenge. The most likely people to respond to the good news of the gospel are people who are already loosely connected to your church, and in the last 2 years, most of them disconnected. So yeah, we've got a moment to engage in the mission, and the moment we're in does not pause the mission we are on. So the question then becomes, what is it that we are going to do? See, for all of us, the words, we all know the verse Esther 4:14, right? And we know it's got a specific situation in a specific context. But here's the reminder. Who knows? Perhaps you've come to your position for such a time as this. This is the moment that God has called us to. And to adopt a post-pandemic missiology needs to acknowledge one thing before we take a break. Is that the moment we're in doesn't pause the mission we're on. But the moment we're in is not dissimilar to past moments. I think it's going to get challenging, right? I think it's getting harder, not easier, more divided, not less so. But I want you to go back with me to 1968. Was anybody 15 years of age or above? Let's even do this. Was anybody 20 years of age or older in 1968? Would you raise your hand? Civil rights movement was in full sway. It's also the year on April 4th that Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. It was also that year Bobby Kennedy was assassinated. If you lived in Chicago, the mayor just sent everybody to the police and said, just break everybody's heads in Grant Park. There were riots. It sounds in some ways similar to 2020, doesn't it? Political division, the DNC was held in Chicago. You probably know the name Dan Rather because of his coverage of the DNC when he's pushed over in this famous moment. You might have actually forgotten, too, that there was a global pandemic that year. Your parents or grandparents, most of you called it the Hong Kong flu. Today we call it H3N2. It's interesting. They didn't shut everything down in 1968. Instead, they started planning Woodstock, which doesn't seem like a good way to contain disease. But that's another story for another day. I want to close this session with this, because in 1968, the world, too, was on fire. After Martin Luther King was assassinated, students at Wheaton College held a vigil. And a pastor sent a letter that circulated on the internet not that long ago. A pastor that you would all know the name of. He since would change his views. He's with the Lord now, but he changed his views after that. But he wrote a letter to Wheaton College saying, I'm paraphrasing, saying, I saw that you held this vigil. I hope it's not true. I hope it's not true what I've heard that you held this vigil. And if it's true, I'm not sending any more students to Wheaton College if you have people having a vigil for that. And it kind of felt that everyone wanted you to take a position and take a stand on something in your church. And if you did, some people were alienated one direction, other people alienated another. But really, there were some things we needed to take stands on. And maybe that's still true today, and I'll talk about that in just a minute. But what I want you to see is in 1968, there was a pastor in Southern California, and he turned to his daughter and said, I'd really like to meet one of these hippies. Because, I mean, hippies. Hippies. Who wants to be a hippie, right? We look back and, like, tell these people. So in 1968, this pastor said to his daughter, I want to meet a hippie. And she brought home a hippie. His name was Lonnie, and they met, and he was a believer, and they began to pray together, and actually became controversial because people didn't like hippies in 1968. Matter of fact, this pastor got in trouble because these hippies started coming to church, and they had Saturday night service. 1,000 people were coming, and so someone said to the pastor, one of the elders of the church said, they're ruining the carpet coming in without shoes and without washing. They're ruining the carpet. No, it's a true story. It's a true story. And the pastor said, then let's tear up the carpet. And 1,000 people started to come. And then that 1,000 people multiplied, and they started these things up and down the West Coast. There were coffee shops. It was the 60s, so they started communes and coffee shops and more. And soon there were dozens. Soon there were thousands of them. And soon there were millions of them. And some historians say 20 to 30 million people trace their spiritual heritage to today, what we call the Jesus People Movement. That pastor by the name, his name was Chuck Smith. The church was Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa. And I bet some of you trace your spiritual heritage to some way to the Jesus People Movement. Does anyone kind of put themselves in that category? I see hands. Yeah. So here's what I want you to hear, because I think it's a wonderful thing what you said backstage. We're going to focus on evangelism, because I think this could be that moment. Because the world's on fire. and you feel the division in your church, and you're going to need reservoirs of resilience and supportive community. Those things I've already said, but can I tell you, the world has none of those things, and what the world needs is a church on mission showing and sharing the love of Jesus in this time and in this place. And the last time the world was on fire was in 1968, and in 1968 began a movement that would impact 20 to 30 million people in their spiritual heritage, including me. A generation later, but the people who came to Jesus in the Jesus People movement are the people who shared the gospel with me. And what I want to say is, I believe we could be at our greatest moment for showing and sharing the love of Jesus. Now, I live a perpetually encouraged life because I've read the end of the book and Jesus wins, right? So I know that. But what I want you to hear and what I want you not to miss is that all around us, people are saying, it's not working. If you thought 3 years ago or 5 years ago or 10 years ago that we'd be in the situation we are now, right? People look around and they're like, well, gosh, the inflation's out of control, right? We got a war in Europe that could expand. We're still recovering from COVID. We got all these things. The nation's divided. We're unsure what the future holds. All these sorts of things. You know what the Lord does historically? He brings revival in moments like that. So we're going to take a break, and when we come back, I'm going to talk about what it might look like if God's people were to join Jesus on mission in the midst of a broken and divided world to point people to him so we might see men and women transformed, born again and transformed by the power of the gospel. So thanks for the opportunity to share with you. We'll be back in 15 minutes.